Hold it, fellas. That don't move me. Let's get real, real gone for a change.
It's time to get real gone on the Rockabilly and Blues Radio Hour. Here's your host, James Riley.
Hey, this is Jam and James Riley on your favorite hour for great music and interviews, the Rockabilly and Blues Radio Hour. Now, coming up, we have part two of our interview with Rocky Burnette.
There's a lot of things about Darrel that remind me of Dorsey. I mean, they're about the same size, but they get that same look in their eye, you know, and they're both extremely talented.
Lots more from him coming up in just a bit, but let's kick things off with a couple of great covers of his dad, Johnny, and Uncle Dorsey Burnette. We've got Robert Gordon, and this one from Levi Dexter and Magic from the Kings of Cat Street Project. It's Lonesome Train on the Rockabilly and Blues Radio Hour.
Lonesome train on a lonesome track. I'm going away. I ain't coming back. I'm going somewhere apart from my baby.
Robert Gordon, and you're listening to Jam and James Riley on the Rockabilly and Blues Radio Hour.
Well, I may got nothing but sweet love on my mind. It really gonna leave me living in love you one more time.
Well, you know I love you, baby. I need you to love me, baby. You better give me some sweet love right this minute, or you're gonna make me mad.
Well, I may got nothing but sweet love on my mind.
About this minute,
I'm a man, got a lot of sweet love on my mind.
That's Robert Gordon with Sweet Love on My Mind from his Bad Boy project in 1980, a song written by Wayne Walker, first recorded by Johnny and Dorsey Burnette in 1956. Johnny's son, Rocky Burnette, is our guest again this hour, and we'll talk to him in just a moment. But first, let's hear a track from his latest project called Rockabilly Boogie with backing by Darrel Higham and the Enforcers. Here's Got the Bull by the Horns.
I got the bull by the horns on a downhill track. It's a better than they ever have been. I missed a lot of loving in my lifetime, but I'm never gonna do it again. Never gonna do it again. I love the brunettes, redheads, and blonde-haired women. I've done it since I don't know when. I go down the line, then I'd love them all. Then I'd start all over again. Start all over again. I got the bull by the horns on a downhill track. Things are better than they ever have been. I missed a lot of loving in my lifetime, but I'm never gonna do it again. Never gonna do it again. I got the bull by the horns on the downhill track. Things are better than they ever have been. I missed a lot of loving in my lifetime, but I'm never gonna do it again. Never gonna do it again. Rumbling and stomping all over this town, trying to find the places you've been. I missed your hugging in the last go around, so I better go around again. Let's go around again. I got the bull by the horns on a downhill drag. Things are better than they ever have been. I missed a lot of loving in my lifetime, but I'm never gonna do it again. Never gonna do it again.
That's Rocky Burnette with Darrel Higham right here on the Rockabilly and Blues Radio Hour. Now, Rocky talked about some of the great family friendships that they had with people like Roger Miller. In fact, sometimes Roger would want to hire some of the band members away from Johnny and Dorsey because he knew they were that great. Here's Rocky Burnette.
Roger Miller did a, hey, who's Dorsey got playing with him? Well, tell him I'll pay him double.
Yeah.
Anyway, Roger was a great buddy. I just saw his kid singing on one of those Sons of the Pioneer type shows. I don't know, but man, he was great.
Yeah.
Sounded just like Roger, you know?
Oh, that's cool.
And Roger was always around the house. Of course, him and Dorsey were best friends. My uncle had two best friends, Roger and Dwayne Eddy. Dwayne Eddy was a good friend.
Oh,
we went
okay.
We went out to the Viva Las Vegas 2 years ago when Dwayne played.
Yeah.
And it was great, man, just seeing him out there, you know, because he was another one of those guys that's just the greatest guy you'd ever want to meet in your life, you know. And the only one that could calm my uncle down. You know, Dwayne would just go up to him and say, "The doors," and my uncle would just calm right down.
Yeah.
And it was like, I don't know, it was fun to see, because Dwayne had that calming effect. You know, he was just that kind of just a great guy, man. I've been so lucky and fortunate in my life to know all these folks, and I feel bad, you know, I'm stuck up here in the woods, you know, and I go too long without seeing them or talk to them. I mean, I think when I saw him in Vegas, him and his wife Deed, I must have hugged him for 5 minutes, you know, and you shouldn't go that long without talking to your pals. But Dwayne was just one of those kinds of guys that all the kids looked up to him, and he was always kind to us. See, that's one thing, you know, we were 9, 10, 11, 12, 13-year-old kids, you know, and these guys, Roger, Glenn Campbell, of course, Dwayne, and, you know, they take time and show us stuff and tell us stuff. And some of the great actors, you know, me and Billy used to go over at James Garner's house, you know, the famous movie star.
Yeah.
We knew his daughter, Gigi, and he liked having a party about once a month and getting all the songwriters around to play the newest tunes, you know. So we'd go over there on different days where there'd be Larry Gatlin and Delaney Bramlett and blah, blah, you name it. And Alex Harvey and Larry Collins from the Collins Kids, we'd go over there, you know, and we'd play our latest tune, you know, and then, you know, just have a party.
Yeah.
And Jim would just be so nice to everybody. In fact, one night we played for James Garner, and he said, "You know what? I'm going to see Dolly tomorrow." And I go, "So are we," because we knew a couple of the kids, you know, that were playing with Dolly. So after the show, we were back in her bus, and I was standing there with James because I'd just been with him the night before. So James introduces me to Dolly, and Dolly comes out of her back of her bus with just her Levi's and her T-shirt on. No shoes, no socks.
Yeah.
And she was actually taller laying down than she would be standing up. You know?
Yeah.
That's how she looked. I mean, she's just adorable. The most beautiful country creature you'd ever see in your life. Dolly Parton, 1979, in just Levi's and a T-shirt and no shoes. And she comes up to James, and James introduces me to her as her biggest fan. And she puts her arms around me.
Yeah.
And kisses me. And I think it's just going to be a regular little kiss, you know, so I kind of drop back, and she grabs the back of my head and pushes it into her face. And then actually, and I've argued with people, and slipped me a little tongue there. And it was the greatest thing. My legs, and then I started realizing how women felt when they were around Elvis. You know, my legs started getting shaky and chaff, and he set me down right there on the bus, the place where the bus driver drives, and everybody in the bus started cracking up because it looked like I was going to faint, and I was. I mean, Dolly Parton had just laid the biggest kiss on me I'm ever going to have in my life.
Yeah.
And, you know, I'm sure it helped having one of the biggest movie stars in the world, James Garner, introduce you as her biggest fan.
Yeah.
But she laid a lip lock on me, man, that I've never forgotten.
That's awesome.
And I tell you what, I didn't wash my face for a week because I still had lipstick on my face.
Yeah.
Oh, I was so proud of that.
Man. I imagined.
So proud of that. The only time I think my cousin Billy was ever jealous of me, he goes, "Hey, man, you got to go and talk to her. She looks like she really..." And I go, "And I'm just going to feel lucky I got that, you know."
Yeah.
She just come off stage, man, to standing ovations. Gone in, cleaned up, put on her Levi's and her T-shirt, and what a woman.
Oh, man,
I'm getting excited about it now.
What a great story. Oh, man.
Yeah. Well, yeah. What a great guy. You know, everybody asked me, you know, he was the greatest movie star that I ever knew in town here. Glenn Campbell and Roger, you know, were the greatest singing stars. And then the biggest TV stars were Chris and Linda Day George. They were like part of the family.
Yeah.
And of course, Mick Fleetwood, you know, from Fleetwood Mac, he's like a member of the family, you know.
You come on like a dream, peaches and cream, lips like strawberry wine. You're 16, you're beautiful, and you're mine. You're all ribbons and curls, you were the girl, eyes that twinkle and shine. You're 16, you're beautiful. And you're mine. Oh, well, you're my baby. You're my pet. We fell in love on the night we met. You touched my hand, my heart all went pop. And you, when we kissed, we could not stop. You walked out of my dreams into my arms. Now you're my angel divine. You're 16, you're beautiful, and you're mine. We